All right, we've been talking quite a bit about February being Heart Month, and today Dr. Jen Arnold and Dr. Jamie Decker join us to answer three questions families should be asking during this month in particular. Good morning. Welcome
back. Good morning. Thanks. It's great to be here.
Yeah, so this is an interesting subject. We're taking a different turn, I think, than what we've been talking about here recently. And let's start with you, Dr. Jamie, and
sure.
Kind of these questions that I think this is interesting. It's a good kind of self-assessment time to making sure that we know very important things for the health of our families. First, how do I know if my child has a heart problem? That's a loaded question.
It is a loaded question. I mean, a little bit of it will depend on the age of the child. You know, some of these heart defects that children have, they're born with, we call them congenital heart defects, and usually it's a developmental problem in the whether in the fetus stage. So there's either a problem with the wall of the heart or one of the valves in the heart, or the blood vessels that come and leave the heart. So those are usually detected prior to birth.
And that's why you say prenatal care so important.
That's right. Prenatal care is critical for these babies, because if we know that they're born with certain diseases, we can mm-hmm. anticipate that, and we can get them to the level of care they need after birth.
Okay.
And so ultrasounds, fetal ultrasounds of the heart called echocardiograms are essential for diagnosing some of these, as you will not know until they're born any symptoms from them.
All right. So now kind of the next step up, where it's not congenital and it's issues that maybe we bring on ourselves, families, or I mean, when does this typically happen with our youth? Unfortunately, we were talking earlier, and it's happening younger now.
Sure, yeah. So aside from congenital heart defects, which aren't always diagnosed when you're first mm-hmm. born, some of these actually, depending on the severity of it, can be diagnosed as you get a little older, so mm-hmm. in school age kids, and some of the acquired heart diseases, such as heart muscle mm-hmm. problems, like cardiomyopathies, can develop when you're a teenager. And so it's important to kind of look for clues of such. So things like complaining of chest pain when you're running or doing exercises, palpitations can sometimes, which are the sensation of feeling abnormally fast or slow or irregular heartbeats, trouble breathing, or if you notice that your child seems to all of a sudden not be able to exercise like they used to, they're getting tired easily, they're taking naps when they're not supposed to be, color changes, those sorts of things can all be signs that there's something wrong with their heart.
Okay. How do we keep our heart the healthiest? Obviously, I know diet is a big part of this. Exercise, you kind of briefly mentioned there, but what are some things we can be doing?
Sure, I mean, I think that's really important. We're seeing a lot of adult, quote unquote, adult mm-hmm. problems, younger and younger and younger children, things like obesity, high blood pressure, high cholesterol. And in fact, the American Academy of Pediatrics actually came out with a consensus statement on how to treat high cholesterol in children, because this is becoming such a prevalent problem.
Wow.
So I think being mindful of what you eat, teaching mm-hmm. children, even young children, how to be almost like label readers, understanding mm-hmm. what they're supposed to eat. You know, they're supposed to have 5 cups of fruits and vegetables, limit the fats, no sugary sweetie drinks such as juices and sodas, and those sorts of things are really important. Regular exercise is very important, especially in the setting of decreasing physical education time in schools. It's really important for parents to push kids to be healthy, doing at least an hour of activity every single day to try and keep them healthy.
Yeah.
Things like no smoking and other lifestyle changes is really important as kids get older as well.
All right, well, good to know. Well, Dr. Jen, I know your passion is CPR, and
yes.
This is a perfect time to bring this up. The last time you were here, one of the last times I was with you, you brought a baby for CPR. We've brought somebody else today, but talk about CPR and what the main message you want to get out with this is today.
Well, I'm excited to be here because it's Heart Awareness Month, and because we know that anyone could have a sudden cardiac arrest for various reasons, for the reasons that you heard Dr. Decker talk mm-hmm. About today, we want to be prepared. We want to know what to do mm-hmm. if that emergency should happen. 70% of cardiac arrests that happen at home. And so it's likely
parents
to be a loved one. Yeah, it could be your child, a spouse, a friend. And so if we're prepared, then we can actually save a life. And in fact, what I'm here to talk about today is hands-only CPR, mm-hmm. because many of us are familiar with traditional CPR, mouth-to-mouth with actual chest compressions. Still the best way for kids and infants. So any child or infant should have the full traditional CPR.
But more people, I think, are apt to do this. That's why I feel like there's a push to know what this is.
So hand CPR is super easy. And what we found is that even just by doing only the hands component mm-hmm. of CPR, you actually have a double or triple likelihood increase of saving a life. So if I were to see someone down on the ground, I might be hesitant or afraid to do mouth-to-mouth and full-on CPR. But if I can just do the hands-only CPR, I'm likely to increase the risk of survival.
You brought a friend with you.
I did.
These are so great. You take these into the community. You're able to offer classes and really kind of teach hands-on. Yep. And, Doctor, you're going to step in and do this.
Dr. Decker's going to help me exemplify. So the important thing with hands-only CPR is the first thing to do is call 911.
Okay.
So that's the first thing you want to do. So I would
be on the phone with 911 and
put it on speakerphone.
Okay.
And then the second thing you do is put your hands on the chest, and then you want to press hard and fast at a rate of 100 to 120 beats a minute. Easy way to remember that, because that seems like a lot of information to know in an emergency. Just to literally sing in your head a song like Stayin' Alive. Stayin' Alive. Bum, 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 bum,
okay.
Staying alive, staying alive. And that gives you the right rhythm that you need to achieve that 100 to 120 beats a minute to have effective CPR.
And then how long are we doing this until they
until
come
help
back
arise.
To, or just until help?
Well,
okay.
If they do become, revived, then you can stop and assess, mm-hmm. but until help arrives, till EMS arrives, and then they can continue to support with all the other treatments that might be needed in that situation.
Wow. All right, good job. Is he all right?
Did we save a life? I know.
Just keep doing it.
Oh, he's alive.
Okay, good.
And one of the things many people want to know how to learn this, the American Heart Association actually has a great website with a video that shows you the hands-only CPR, and then you can also sign up for a class so you can learn full-on CPR.
The perfect way to end. guys, thank you so much for being here this morning. We
thank
really
you for
appreciate
having
it,
us.
Doctors. Oh, we appreciate it.
Thank
and,
you.
We certainly appreciate all that you do in the community.
Thank you.
We'll see you again soon.
Thanks.